leads us in that first night, that first Christmas night, when love was born that night. And that was in that baby Jesus in that manger. And that will lead us in to the next 4 weeks, which I've prepared four sermons on Christmas, leading up to Christmas Day. And I realize that Christmas Day is on a Sunday. That day we will be having worship service that morning. That's all we'll be having that day is worship. Because I don't know of a much greater day other than Easter Sunday that you could come into the Lord's house and remember that day when he was born. You've got to remember that. That started it and that ended it when he came. He was the answer. So next Sunday, we'll begin that. Today is the last Sunday of November. For those that have been listening to me, you know that on the last Sunday of the month, I always go to the next psalm, which we are now up to Psalm 83. For 83 months that we've been here and we've preached. So if you have your Bibles, and will turn with me to the 83rd psalm. We'll read it, and then I'll share some insights about it to you. Would you, if you find the 83rd Psalm, stand with us together, and let's read it together. Honor God with the reading of His holy word. Keep not thy silence, O God, and hold not thy peace, and be not still, O God. For lo, my enemies make a tumult, and they that hate thee have lifted up the head. They have taken crafty counsel against thy people and consulted against the hidden ones. They have said, come and let us cut them off from being a nation, for that name of Israel may be no more in remembrance. For they have consulted together with one consent, and they are a confederate against thee. The tabernacles of Edom and the Ishmaelites of Moab and the Hagarenes, Gibel and Ammon and Amalek, the Philistines with the inhabitants of Tyre. Assur also is joined with them that have opened the children of Lot, Selah. Different part of prayer now. Do unto them as unto the Midianites, as to Sisera, as to Jabin at the brook of Kishon, which perished at Endor, that became as dung for the earth. Make their nobles like Oreb and like Zeb, yea, all their princesses as Zeba and Zalmah. I want to tell you what happened to all these people. They're dead. They went against Israel, and he goes back to that. Who said, let us take them ourselves to the house of God in possession? Oh, my God, make them like a wheel, as the stubble before the wind, as the fire burneth as wood, and the flame setteth the mountains on fire. Persecute them with thy tempest, and make them afraid with thy storm. Fill their faces with shame, that they may seek thy name, O Lord. Let them be confounded in trouble forever. Let them be put to shame and perish. Last verse, listen to this. That men may know that thou, whose name alone is Jehovah, art the Most High over all the earth. Father, I thank you, God, that, Lord, you are Jehovah. And that, God, you sent your Son to come to this earth, Lord, that we might one day be able to go to you. Now, God, as we look at this scripture today, and we think on this subject that we're talking about here, that, oh, my God, what are we going to do? And there's times in our life, Lord, when we question and we wonder how we're going to make it or what we're going to do to get through it, but yet we've got to understand that, Lord, you are our fortress and you are our refuge. And you're the one that we can go to in our time of weakness when we need help. And here we have a man that is praying for his country, praying for his people, praying, God, that you will be with them, take care of them. Lord, I pray now as we look at this, that, God, you touch our hearts and let us know how much you love us and care about us. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. When you look at this psalm and you begin to study it, what you find is that if you live long enough, that there'll probably be some dark hours that come in your life. If you live long enough, there'll be some times when prayer will be more necessary in your life than it's ever been to you, when it will mean more to you than at any other time. You see, today, the thing of praying every day, praying in the morning when you get up, or praying at night, when your darkest hour comes, let me tell you when you pray. All the time. All the time. When you need help and you can't find it. When you need an answer and you can't get it. When you're looking and looking and nothing seems to be turning in your direction, you pray. You pray. That's when we pray the most. There will come times, I believe this, in your life, that except God do something, it will never get done. Unless God answers, there's no hope with this. That's why we pray, and that's why we plead with Him. Now, when the writer of this psalm prays, this is what I would call a national anthem. He's praying for his nation, right? He worries about Israel because of the many enemies that have come against it. And we'll talk about that tonight in our Nehemiah study. Always under attack. Always somebody hating them. Always somebody trying to destroy them. But he realized that there was a God in Israel, that there is a God in heaven. And the Bible tells us this, and you can take it in two ways, or I'll put it to you in two ways. The Bible says that salvation belongs to the Lord. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Now, I believe that in my personal life, that nobody can go to heaven or nobody can be saved, nobody can make it right unless God does it. I believe with a nation or a country that has turned its back and has turned its back on God and lived for God, that God is still in heaven and God can make it right again if the people will get their heart right. The salvation for my soul and many times the salvation for our nation is in the hands of God, whether He's going to do something or not. That's the salvation He's begging for here. He's praying for deliverance, that God would rescue His people from the trials that they're going through. So this is a national prayer that he is praying here. But I want to just tell you something. You can pile all the troubles that there are together in a pile. And you can get them from China, Russia, America, India, Africa. You take every problem that this world is dealing with today, put them in a pile, and we serve a God that can heal and can answer and can fix those problems if we would just trust Him. That's just the deal. Our God is that powerful that He can help. God is greater. Remember when our kids say their blessing? God is great. God is good. They'll say that, and I'll repeat it, never really understanding sometime how great and how good God is to us. How many times He is, you know, I listened to a song this week on a CD. And I had to listen to it several times for me to get what it was. And that song talked about the fact that when you're on the mountain with Jesus, things look different than when you're on the mountain by yourself. Because, see, this is the thing. And this is what the song says. I had to listen to it a bunch of times to get the whole meaning of this. The valleys look different when Jesus is there. But when you get on the mountain, you begin to look at all your life, then you'll realize, you'll never realize all God did for you. You took some roads that had you not taken them, your life would be in a big mess now. But God led you down the right road, and you never knew when you said no to this or no to that, and you said yes to this, that God was in the midst of that looking out for you and letting you go that way. He took you the right way. It looks different, our lives, as God looks at us. And so he pleased with God. The world that he is talking about then is much like the world that we live in today. At the time this psalm was written, the world was living in great violence, great sin. There was much wrong. If you would go back to the very second psalm that I preached the second month I was here, there was a question asked in that psalm. Why do the heathen rage? Why did those that don't love God or care about the church, why are they raging and showing themselves as much as they are? And how, it says in that scripture, how can they imagine such a vain thing? How can they think up all the evil and sin and stuff that is in the world? How can they do that? In the book of Revelation, when you go to the 11th chapter, another question is asked. Why are the nations so angry? Why is there such anger? He was asking that some 2,500 years ago in the world that he lived in. What he was saying, this world is violent. The heathen are ruling. The heathen are reigning. And he asked the question, God, why is that? And then as he goes through the history of the world, Revelation 11:18. He says, why are the nations angry? Why is everybody so mad? What is going on that people are acting like the way they do? And he was terribly upset about it. He says in verse 2, for thy enemies make a tumult. They riot. They hate thee. And they have lifted up their head. He looked at the world that he live in. He said, Lord, the world that we live in now, way back yonder, hates thee. And I propose to you that the majority of the world that exists and lives in the world in times you live in 2022 hate God. The world in itself, most all the world does not care about God or the things of God, and they will do everything they can to stop God, and many times they don't know it. But what he knew was what? That outside the walls of Jerusalem, that there was an enemy that was going to attack them. Why did they hate them so bad? And so he talks to God and he says to God, they have, when it says in verse 2 that they lifted up their head, this is very important. I would overlook that and never understood what it means until I read it. And it says in that scripture that they have lifted up their head. They've hated you, God, and now they're lifted. This is the world we live in today. It means, and Lord, they have become more vocal now. They have become louder now. People do not mind cursing God or cursing the things of God, making fun of you and me as Christians, making fun of the church. People are more vocal now and will tell you up front, I'm an agnostic, I'm an atheist, I'm a this or I'm a that. They're not ashamed of that. He said, why are the people more vocal now than what they were? Why? And then he kind of gives a hint as to why he thinks the world is like it is. In verse 4, he says this. They said, come, let us cut them off and from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be no more in remembrance. Where does the Bible tell us God's heart? What nation does the Bible tell us? What people does the Bible tell us God's heart was with? Israel. Folks, that ain't ever changed. Leaders come, centuries go, we're way down the road and moving toward the end, and you know what? Hey, there's nothing new under the sun. You look that from the very time of the beginning and existence of the nation of Israel, and he talks about and he names people here that they battled over the years, they've always been those that were beguiled by Satan that have always wanted to remove Israel from the face of the earth. Always been that way. Always been a hated nation. A hated nation. You see, when you look at these things and you live in the world that we live in. And it started, as I've been teaching, I started on Wednesday nights. I'm going to be teaching on the women of the Bible. And I started out with the first one, Eve. I got one more sermon on that, and I'll finish that up Wednesday night. In the very first chapter, the serpent, Satan, came in the picture. Suddenly, nobody paid him much attention, but he was there. And then when he got to Eve, he began to speak. And the Bible says about him that he's a liar and that the truth is not in him, and yet he is deceiving the whole world, has always done that. He is a deceiver, is what he is. And so Israel has had to deal with this. And he lists in here many of the nations. I'm not going over them. But he lists in here many of the nations that have tried to get rid of Israel. He lists them there because of his hatred for Israel. Satan has always hated them, has always despised them, has always done. You've had from the time of the biblical times when all these nations come in there and tried to destroy him, when the Roman government, which was the most powerful people in the world, thought they would go in and destroy Israel. In 70 AD, they went in, destroyed it, tore it down, burned it up, cast the people out into the desert, out into a far land. And for 2,000 years, nobody ever heard of Israel. They had no land. Their land belonged to these enemies that had kicked them out and had took them over, and Israel was nothing. But God can change things in a minute. God can. He's working toward his plan for redemption and his plan toward the end. So what happened about 70 years ago? He'd come alive again. Jesus said in Matthew 24, in his signs of the ends of time, that the fig tree might not be bearing right now, and you got to understand that for nearly 4,000 years, it didn't bear anything. Nothing. The world thought they'd heard the last of them. But the Bible says, as we approach the end times and the last day, that there's going to be new blossoms that's going to come on that fig tree. And all of a sudden, after 2,000 years of dying, that fig tree's going to come alive again. That's Israel. And I'm here to tell you, here we are 70 years later from when that day happened in May of 1948. And Israel's thriving. Israel ain't never had it easy as a nation. There's always been somebody that wanted them dead. There's always been somebody that wanted to take their city, take their land. During the time that David was king, most powerful nation in the world. Solomon, likewise. But ever since that, it's been a downhill slide for them because they moved away from God and they paid a price for that. You see that list of people that have always been their enemy. This. And he talks about these nations. And when you read that, remember I read you that list when I read it to you? If I gave you a map of Israel today, and you started at the north and went to the east and the south and the west, and you went around it, You know what you'd find? Every one of those nations had Israel surrounded. They were always enemies of Israel. Always wanted them done away with. Their greatest enemy. And we've talked about this a lot in my prophecy preaching. Especially in Nehemiah and Daniel and Isaiah. The people that hated Israel, I guess many would say that it was the Philistines, where the giant came from, or you might say some other nation. But I don't believe there's anybody that has ever lived that hated Israel, and this is just Jimmy's opinion, more than the Assyrians did. You hear so much about the Assyrians and their hatred and the things that they wanted to do to do this. And this was that powerful nation from the north. The Assyrians were the ones that were the northern people. If you remember and read that, there's 10 nations there. At the end of the world, the Bible says there'll be a 10-nation confederacy that will raise his head against Israel. God will defeat them. But they will come after Israel when it's time or when God says it's time. And so the question is, in verse 12, the writer says, who said, let us take to ourselves the houses of God in possession? Lord, who thinks that they can take your house? God, who thinks that they have a right to possess your land? Ever since the nation of Israel has existed, there's always been a nation and a people that believe they deserve the right to possess that land. Here we are, thousands of years later, and you look at the enemies of Israel and they're no different than they've been. You've got all of the superpowers. If he were to rewrite this book now and write in there where he wrote all those enemies before, you would see such names as Syria, Iran, Russia, China. Those nations of that 10-nation confederacy from the east, that's what you would see in there now, because thee has people just like Iran that their goal, and they make no bones about it, is to wipe Israel off the face of the map. They want all of Israel demolished. They want all Jews killed. That is the desire, and that's what they say that they will do. But I'm here to tell you, just like all these other nations, they'll fail. Israel will always exist. And when the Lord comes back, I know it's going to exist, because the Bible says when he comes back, that's where he's coming back to. So it's got to be there. He says that they'll come into the land at one time, and it will be the last time they'll come into the land. And I believe when they went back in 1948 and the fig tree blossomed, that was the last time they would have to claim that land again, that it would be theirs forever until Jesus come back. And this guy that wrote this will finally see his prayers answered. He said, Lord, you're going to do something. God, you're going to claim your land. You're going to let these other people that have battled and warred against us, are you going to let them have the land? And his answer was no. No, it's not going to happen. I look back, I wrote down a couple of things here. Some of the people that's warred against Israel that this guy's writing about. Pharaoh. Remember Pharaoh? In Egypt, that made them slaves. Babylonians, those that were here for my prophecy teaching on Daniel, we knew the Babylonians, didn't we? Wanted to destroy Israel. Then later on, there was what was called the Crusades that happened in the world. And they thought they would get Israel. Then in the 15th century, they later on was a group of extremists that went in and were going to destroy Israel. At the end of the century, the 15th century, Spain came in and took over that land. So they've always, you go on up to today. Then after that came a guy named Hitler that killed 6 million Jews and thought he could wipe out everything about the Jewish nation and the Jewish people and he would just kill them. And why did he do that? Well, why did the Egyptians try? What did the Pharaoh come in and say? We're going to have to kill these people because they're becoming too many. They're growing faster than we are. And if we don't do something with them and get them out of the land, they will take the land from us. So we've got to stop the increase of the Israelite nations. And so we will make them slaves and they will not have children and they will do this. So that was their reason for this. Then later on, in the not so far back past, when Israel had drifted into much of the land and many of them had gone into what we call the European nations, why did the European nations turn against them? Because they were prosperous. They made money. They were smart. And they were afraid that they would have more money and they would have more knowledge. And so they said, we have got to eliminate them because we're afraid they'll be smarter than us and be richer than us. So we know that. Why did Hitler want to destroy Israel and the Jewish people? Because their skin was not the same color as yours, as theirs was. They were Aryans. They were darker skinned. And so he wanted everybody to be just as white as I am. And so he marched 6 million of them in there and he killed them there. Now understand, and I got to quit. This is a battle that started in the first book of the Bible. Genesis 3:15, it says this. This is God talking about the serpent, talking about Satan, the snake, the liar, the one that's brought all the damage into the world that ever existed is because of him. Man lived in a perfect place, the Garden of Eden, and he destroyed that, and we've paid a price for it ever since. But listen to what the Bible says, and this is where it started. God said, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and his. He will crush your head. You will strike his heel. What's he saying? I don't know. I guess it could happen. I don't know. That you could ever kill anybody by crushing their heel. You might make them lame. But I don't know that you could kill anybody. And so God says to Satan in that scripture, oh, you can crush people's heel. You can make them hurt. All of us have been in pain sometime because Satan has messed up our lives. But he said, but the one that's coming, talking about Jesus, will crush his head. When Jesus comes and the Jews come, you will have some victories, but you're not going to win the war. Satan's a loser, and he's going to lose. It may look at the world, and I'll tell you how bad it looks and all these things, but folks, this is just where we live today. Why? Maybe there's a lot of questions asked. Why? Does Satan have such a hatred for the Jewish people? Why? Because of Bethlehem. Because of that first Christmas. When he was born of Mary and Joseph. And the Savior of the world came through the nation of Israel. Now remember, Jesus and Satan have always been enemies. Even before they created anything, they were in heaven together. He got kicked out. He's always hated them because the Messiah came through them. And when you look at the history of Israel, and you read the Psalms, the writers of Psalms, how many times have I taught you a psalm where they said, God help our nation. They're killing us, Lord. They're doing this. Remember, we've been through this so many times. Why? Why? Well, I don't know that I know the answer to that other than what I told you, that he came from the nation of Israel. But I do know this. That the story of the history of Israel is a mystery of why they had to go and deal for centuries and thousands of years with a world that hated them. But not only is the story of Israel a mystery, the story of Israel is also a miracle. That God took a man named Abraham that did not know him, saved him, made him the father of the Jewish people, made a covenant with him that God would take care of them and that they would be his nation forever, that he would bless those that bless Israel and he would curse those that curse Israel. And any nation that wants to go against Israel, understand something, they're going to lose. There's no more. There is nobody. They might have had victories in the Bible, but I believe there ain't no more victories for anybody that goes against Israel now. That's done. Their survival is a miracle. That no other, many of these nations that we mentioned in there that 2,000 or 3,000 years ago, they don't even exist anymore. But you know who does exist? Israel. And sad thing about America is this. We got idiots up there in Washington that do not want to do anything with Israel. Don't want to give them arms anymore. Just want to just break relations with them. Folks, I know we're dumb, but I hope we don't ever get that dumb. Because God says when you do, there's a curse coming on you. So we need they need to keep that in mind. Last verse, I got to quit. Time's up. He asked them to take care of their enemies. He prays God to take care of our enemies in these verses. And then he comes to the last verse. Not just so that Israel's enemies will be gone, but he said, when you do this, men may know that thou, whose name alone is Jehovah, art the Most High over where? All the earth. And I think he's talking about that last days. Now you do remember, most of you done heard me preach so much about this. God, he lays out human history. Human history was laid out before Adam and Eve were ever made. He already had it laid out. Number two, God hears the prayers of his people. God heard this prayer. God hears the prayers of his people. And sometimes, aren't you glad that in the most difficult situation you get in, when you think about your life and the things you've been through, or maybe the things you're going through, that God can step in and make it better. Can help you see the light when everything looks so dark. That's what my God does. He acts. Not only hear prayers, but he acts in the tough situations. And he says, God, one thing people will learn when it's all said and done. It's a shame that it's got to be when it's all said and done. But that you are the God over all the earth. It ain't the leaders here or the leaders in China or Russia or Iran that God, you will defeat all of them without raising your hand. Oh, they're boasting and they're there. But I want to tell you something. The Bible, I'm chasing rabbits now, but I got to quit. The Bible talks about people repenting and having to face God. And we all got, listen, everybody sitting here has got to meet God one day. You make no bones about it, you got to see. There's also in there a Bible set that says what? That the nations will be judged too. See, that's a forgotten thing by most people that live in the world, even in our pulpits. God said that there will also be a judgment of the nations at the end of time. And just like the Bible says, when you go to meet God and I go to meet Him, if I'm His child, I have no fear of facing God. I look forward to the day. But think about a nation. Think about a nation that has to meet God, that have rejected Him, have done everything that they can to do away with His people and to do away with His land. How would you like to be the leader of that nation? Are the people of a nation that have done that? Because God hears, God watches, God sees. And what it tells us is this, that when we're going through our tough times, I know y'all hear me preach, so that's the only thing about staying in a place for any length of time and preaching. Sometimes you just have to listen to the same old things. You know, you just have to listen to, well, I done heard you say that before, preacher. Yeah. I probably wouldn't say it again if I could remember that I'd said it before, but since my memory's not good, I can't remember sometimes I said it before. So you just have to listen to it. You just have to listen to it. Truth of the matter. Everybody has to give an account of their life. Good or bad. He opens books up. You see, probably the only name for me where my name is really important to anybody is the IRS. Right? The people that I owe money to, my name is important to them. But other than that, my name will never be written down anywhere. About the best I can do right now in my life is y'all put my name on that bulletin every Sunday. That's about the best I can do right now. Or will ever do, probably. But the Bible says that one day when I go to heaven, I'll have a whole shelf. I just wonder what kind of building that's going to be. God's got everybody that ever lived, and He's got the record of their lives. And I mean, how many books has He got on me? Well, it's according to whether He keeps the good or the bad. It may not be as many as I think. But He sees me, and He knows me, and He knows my mind, and He knows my heart. So when I stand before Him, I'd like to think, and I promise you there's a lot of things I may worry about, and I'm not saying that we ought to worry. Sometimes you can't help it. You got enough human in you, you can't help but worry a little bit. I'm not too worried about that because we're saved by grace through faith. It's a gift of God. I'm a child of God. Not because I've done anything or because my name's written down. The main thing, you want your name written down, not with the IRS or with anywhere else, but your name written down in that, when he goes into the Lamb's Book of Life, that you find your name in there. Because if your name is not found in the Lamb's Book of Life, let me tell you this. You're going to have a short stay in heaven. I promise you, it won't take God long to deal with me there. And I can't go and hire all these high-priced defense attorneys, because ain't nobody going to be in the room with him but me. And there's no need saying, Lord, I would have done this or I would have done that. Because he already knows why you did this or why you did that. So as we leave here today, he prays for his nation. God, would you help us? God, will you hear my prayers? And I will tell you, as a child of God, the privilege that we forget the most that we have is the privilege of prayer. Oh, what a great privilege we have. I hear Reverend Gardner when he says his prayers for us. One of the things that he'll always say most of the time, not every time, but he'll say, God, thank you that we have a privilege to come before your throne. Thank you, God, that we bow our heads like this guy that wrote this psalm said, that, Lord, you listen to us. Sometimes that's the only hope you got. But like an old preacher told me one time, if you get down to where that's your only hope, you're in a good place. If God's your only hope, you're in a good place. Thank God for hearing prayers. So as we have our hymn of invitation today, if there's something that you need to talk with God about, or you need to hear from God, or really something you'd like for God to do, the Bible says if two or three will come together to pray on anything, that God will hear from heaven and he'll answer our prayers. Let's pray about it. That's what he did. How many times have I sat with people that had problems and were going through the troubles of life, and the only thing that I could say to them was what? Let's pray about it. I didn't know what the answer was. I didn't know how to help them. I said, I can pray with you. Sometimes we just need to take it to God. If you're here today and you're not sure about this, when the roll is called up yonder, the song says, I'll be there. And you're not sure about your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, what a perfect day to just come and say, preacher, I want to get my relationship right with you. I want to know that when I leave this world, I'm going to be okay. It's so simple. The devil speaks and says, don't listen to him. Don't listen to what that word says. Just wait a little longer. Wait till next Sunday. That's what the devil tells you. Jesus said, today is the day of salvation. Don't pass the day up. Be sure you know that you know what you know, that you know the Lord. Mimi, what are we singing? Hymn number 330. Would you stand with us, please? If you need a prayer, you need somebody to pray with you about something, if you need the Lord, if you want to be sure things are right, you come. Amazing grace has saved a wretch like me. Found. Can you say that now? Thank you. God loves you and cares about you more than anybody else. Thank you so much for being here today. I'm going to ask you to come back tonight. You know, if you want to start getting your life kicking in gear and getting closer to God, tonight would be a good time. You're going to love it because I'm going to preach about God's junkyard tonight. God, if you want to see if God's got a junkyard, you come tonight and I'll prove to you he does. Okay? Brother Kent, would you dismiss us with prayer?